Loving Father, I thank you for the opportunity to be here with these men, to explore your word, to look at Paul as an example of what you want us to be. But Lord, more so, we need to look at Jesus as an example of what you want us to be and what you see us as already. We are cloaked in his righteousness, Lord, and we thank you for that. But until we are away from this place and in your presence, we'll still be struggling from the stuff of this earth. And Lord, you're here with us every move we make. We pray that you'll be here tonight to point out to each of us what we need to take away from this time together, that you will reveal to us any flaws in our character, our selfishness, our pride, and shine a light on it so that that darkness can be revealed and be eliminated. And Lord, we know that this is your house and the enemy has no place here. So he is far from this place during our time together. And Lord, we pray these things in the name of our Lord, our Savior, but also our friend and brother, Jesus Christ. Amen. All righty. And on the handout, I said it, but you have last week's life lessons as well as this week. So if you missed last week, you can at least get a synopsis, and I'll give you a little bit of that as well. And hopefully that's a keeper for a while. Last week we talked about Paul being willing to take risks. His challenges to authority were made with respect to God's greater authority. So instead of just being a rebel like some of us have been and maybe still are, he was only rebellious to authority when God's authority was challenged. And outside of that, he made use of the authorities that God had put in place. In the midst of anger at him and threats against his life, we saw that Paul was able to take correction, and that's something we want to emulate. And also, as he opened up this chapter, we hear him remark that he lives his life in good conscience before God, which allows him to rely on God and remain safe in the hands of God in a precarious situation. So let's see what trouble Paul is in this week as we read on, starting in verse 11 of chapter 23. And in my Bible, it was subtitled, A Plot to Kill Paul. So right off the bat, we know he might be endangered. Verse 11, the following night, the Lord stood by him and said, take courage, for as you have testified to the facts about me in Jerusalem, so you must testify also in Rome. When it was day, the Jews made a plot and bound themselves by an oath neither to eat nor drink till they had killed Paul. There were more than 40 who made this conspiracy. They went to the chief priests and elders and said, we have strictly bound ourselves by an oath to taste no food till we have killed Paul. Now therefore, you, along with the council, give notice to the tribune to bring him down to you, as though we were going to determine his case more exactly, and we are ready to kill him before he comes near. Now the son of Paul's sister heard of their ambush, so he went and entered the barracks and told Paul. Paul called one of the centurions and said, take this young man to the tribune, for he has something to tell him. So he took him and brought him to the tribune, and said, Paul, the prisoner, called me and asked me to bring this young man to you, as he has something to say to you. The tribune took him by the hand and going aside asked him privately, what is it that you have to tell me? And he said, the Jews have agreed to ask you to bring Paul down to the council tomorrow, as though they were going to inquire something more closely about him. But do not be persuaded by them, for more than 40 of their men are lying in ambush for him, who have bound themselves by an oath neither to eat nor drink till they have killed him. and now they are ready, waiting for your consent. So the tribune dismissed the young man, charging him, "Tell no one that you informed me of these things." All right. We mentioned last week, and we'll start out again. We need to be aware that we are in a war. And though our physical situation is much calmer than Paul's is, it is no less and maybe more dangerous spiritually than where Paul was. In our lives, it's easy to be complacent, forget about the warfare, and it makes easy targets for a vigilant enemy. Verse 11 is a transition verse between 1 to 10 and 12 to 22, and different Bible editors will put it in one section or the other, but I kind of believe it belongs more in the second section that we just read, because it provides the basis by which Paul stands. It also provides our first life lesson. Life lesson one, when God speaks, that is the truth in a situation, regardless of what the facts might be otherwise. Jesus is the truth. Truth is not a situational proposition of fact. Now, what the heck does that mean? I just used a lot of big words to impress you with my intellectual abilities and without a sip, I probably won't be able to go on, but we got it. A few definitions for clarity there. In philosophy, a proposition has a slightly different meaning than it does in general usage. In general usage, I can proposition a young lady, it means one thing. Or I can propose that we go out to eat, and that means another. But the idea is that I'm offering something for you to accept. In philosophy, it's a little different in that it's more of an assertion of the truth. I am a man is a propositional truth that you are expected to accept. Now, these days, that's getting a bit more ambiguous. But, and some of you may have an argument about whether I'm a man or not, but for the most part, I say I'm a man, and you will accept that proposition. And for this, Jesus taught using examples. That wasn't a very good one, so I'm going to use him in this illustration. Since I'm proposing to you that Jesus is the truth, not the situational fact, that's the truth. Let's look at Lazarus. And we're going to look at Lazarus when Jesus finally arrives. Lazarus is dead and will remain so. That's a pretty reasonable proposition of truth according to all logic and rational indicators of what's going on that day at the grave. Even in the exceedingly unlikely event of no one noticing he was still breathing while they were preparing him for burial, the possibility of a man being buried alive without food or water when he was critically ill and then surviving for 4 days is infinitesimally small. So all of you reading the Bible, did any of you think, oh, he's not really dead when they said he's been in the grave 4 days and by now he stinks? We accepted that propositional truth, but was that the truth? Not once Jesus got involved. Jesus speaks the truth and Lazarus lives and walks out of the grave, which wouldn't have happened if he had been deathly ill and not fed for 4 days, even if he had been alive. But it is pretty clear he was not, but the truth was Jesus when he said, "Come out of the grave." All right, I'm going to give you a physics proposition. Who loves physics here? You better, or your knees aren't going to work, are they? Or elbows. I loved astronomy so much when I was in college that I took it 3 times before I finished the course. I did ace it, but you should with all that practice. And this is somewhat akin to that. We're going to talk about bodies. But I'm going to give you the proposition that I can physically fit on the head of a standard size pin. So I'm not trying to fool you with my language. Does anybody believe I can physically stand on the head of a, and this is a play on the angels, how many angels will fit on the head of a pin? Does anybody believe that's possible? The standing part, no. But I can physically fit on the head of a standard size pin. It sounds absurd. And I'm not going to be alive if it happens, which is why I'm not going to be standing. But you could fit my physical body on the point of a pin if you increased my density and decreased my volume to that of a neutron star. And we know those exist. So I would be small enough to fit on the point of the pin, not just the head, if we were able to do that to me. I'd rather you didn't. But to get that in perspective, and the reason I'm saying I could fit on the point, the entire Earth would fit like a golf ball on top of a golf tee if you put it in a football stadium, and it was the same density as a neutron star. So think of the entire Earth sitting in a football stadium. You can get smaller than that, but that's where the physics breaks down because you got to remove all of the space between, you got to stop electrons from moving, and we don't even know if we can do that, but everything would have to be frozen and packed tight. But at that point, you could fit the Earth in a teaspoon. Only God can lift that teaspoon, but that is physically, if we break down the bonds and we won't go into depth there, but if you break down all of the physical laws we have and just have the matter, the entire Earth could fit in a spoon. Weird concept. Who saw The Matrix? Anybody like it? I absolutely loved that movie. It blew my mind. And it really was all about that. We are kind of living in illusion, even in the real world. And we recognize that this is God's creation, and He can do with it whatever He wishes. So what we consider reality isn't necessarily. Excuse me. So the only truth is God, Jesus, the Holy Spirit. They are the truth in every situation, and everything else is just our illusion of perception. And that's one of those mind blowers for me, but I've always enjoyed living in the unreal world. This reminds me of a joke that has no point here at all, but I always loved the bumper sticker that said, "Reality is for those that can't handle science fiction or fantasy," but I prefer the science fiction. So, reality is if you really can't handle the unreal. All right, back to verse 11, which is the reality that God expressed that gives Paul all the assurance he needs. He says, "You're going to be in Rome, so should he fear for his life?" The only way he will is if he doesn't believe God, which is not a good place to be. All right, let's look at his situational proposition of truth that we find in the circumstance of Paul. And I'm not going to reread it for time's sake, but go ahead and scan verses 12 through 15 if you got your Bible while I talk about it. We have 40 plus guys that have pledged to not eat or drink until they've killed Paul. Okay, to say that looks bleak is kind of an understatement. And I don't know about you, but you can look at me and figure out that I'm going to be highly motivated if I have to accomplish something before I can eat or drink. So I'm going to do all I can to accomplish that task. And here you got at least 40 guys that are out to kill Paul. All right, and here I had visions of a B-grade Japanese fighting movie where this happens, but it's not the reality and wouldn't have been. But even if all these guys come at Paul one at a time and we eliminate surprise, which they probably are going to surprise him. If they don't, they aren't doing a very good job of being assassins. And if we eliminate the fact that, you know, Paul's not this buff, tough, 8th degree black belt, but really sounds like a pretty wimpy guy physically. Now, in no other way would I ever say that about Paul, but there's nothing to indicate he's anything other than physically challenged, and there's a few things that imply that's the case. Try not to cough into this thing, but that makes it worse, doesn't it? Sorry. All right. Looking at 40 guys, the odds of him surviving the first 20 attacks would be approximately 2 in 10 million. Now, if you want to know how many it would be for 40, multiply 2 in 10 million times 2 in 10 million, because I went halfway. So 4 in however many zeros that generates, and I was afraid to do that because I was pretty sure I couldn't pronounce what it was called, and it wouldn't mean anything to you anyway. But that's likely to be, in probability, an impossibility, except in Hollywood where it happens all the time, but we know how real the movies are. But for if they are evenly matched combat-wise, that's a 2 in 10 million for 20 guys to attack him and him survive. So let's look with me at the verses that God allows Paul's nephew to hear about the vow. Now that we've sort of seen, God was apparently in this from the beginning. The nephew gets to speak to Paul, which as a prisoner may have been a minor miracle in itself. Apparently, at most, this is a young man and probably would not get the attention, much less the permission, to be able to go and see Paul, despite the fact that he is a Roman citizen. But getting in there was a bit of a miracle in itself. But the kid gets in and he tells Paul what's going to happen. And how does Paul react? Does he freak out, oh no, these guys are going to kill me? We don't know how much anxiety that created because it doesn't really say it. But looking at his response, there apparently isn't an over-the-top concern. If there was, it is not evident in the text. What we see presented in the text really looks like a very calm reaction. He asks the centurion, which actually is probably the captain of the guard, because a centurion is not going to be your guard. There'll be a Roman soldier, but he got hold of the soldier's boss, the centurion, and said, take this young man to see the tribune. All right, that wouldn't happen without divine intervention. And that intervention may have been Paul being a citizen of Rome, which was a well-established, you know, you got to take care of this prisoner and do well by him. But even as a citizen of Rome, there's no reason to assume that, you know, he tells the captain of the guards what to do, and he does it. But that happens. And he does Paul's bidding. So the nephew gets to go to the tribune, and he finds a favorable ear there. And that, again, another thing that God was in control of, because that's not a normal reaction for a kid to get to go to, in effect, what was the judge that would be over this case. And having a witness be able to go to the judge even today would be a problem. But then, you know, they would not pay attention to this young boy. But the tribune listens to him. He has a favorable ear to the kid, and he sets about to save Paul with virtually no action on the part of Paul. And that brings me to life lesson number two. When God says he will do something in your life, allow him to lead you in what you should do. And more importantly, don't try to do what only he can do. If he's told you this is going to happen, well, I won't say sit back, but sometimes watching God work is A, more difficult, and B, more of an encounter with God than trying to do the work ourselves. And that is our human tendency. And I won't bore you with the illustration, but one of the early times that I heard from God, I reacted this way, and I dare say most of us could or probably would. It's, "Thank you very much, Lord." And then we dive in and do it our way on our strength. Anybody ever done that when you heard from God? Okay. And now the guys that have heard from God won't be offended by me later, and I'm glad to see there are a few hands there. But during that time, my efforts did nothing. But God, each step of the way, had something. I basically had to look to see what he had done and was doing and follow him in that rather than do what I heard him say to do and then got creative with how to do it and what that meant exactly. So we want to avoid reading into what God tells us anything more than that. And Paul heard, "You're going to Rome." So he knows, I'm not going to die here, despite the odds being stacked heavily against him. But if you do it on your own strength, it's not going to work out well. Trust me. All right, I've gotten to the point of being offensive here. I'm going to make two statements now, and these are my interpretation of Scripture, and it's based on both my experience and my observation. But I want to challenge you to test these according to your Holy Spirit-guided understanding of the Scripture. And I'm not going to give you a bunch of verses. If you want to pursue it, look for the kind of topic. I said this may challenge, I'm hoping it does challenge some of you, and it may offend a few, and I'm hoping it doesn't offend, but if it does, look for the challenge in that. If I don't sneeze or cough, that will be God performing a miracle before this is over. I don't know what's going on, but sorry. All righty. Listen carefully for any application God may have for you in this. And two propositions that I see as truth. One, if you never hear from God, there's something fundamentally wrong in your relationship with Jesus. The Scripture says, "My sheep hear my voice." And that doesn't mean God audibly talks to you in the shower every morning. It does mean that when you hear from God, from Jesus, you're going to know it. And if you haven't, then talk to a spiritually mature Christian and look at why you might not be hearing from God. Most often it's because we're not listening. And that's easy to do in our noisy world. But if you have accepted Jesus, you are trying to be, well, as Paul put it earlier, and we had in the first session, you're trying to, my brain just shut down, I'll cheat and look. Live your life in good conscience before God. Like I said last week, that hit me as, that's really a cool saying. Maybe I should think of making it a life verse because it's a lot shorter than the one I have chosen, but if that appeals to you, I kind of like that too. But if you haven't ever heard God's voice, then either you're not listening, or worse, you really don't have the relationship with him you think you do. And that should be pursued. And the second one is maybe harder, and it is kind of harder to substantiate in Scripture. But if you hear from God all the time, and I'm not about to say you don't, I can say I don't, but if you hear from him all the time, you need to test to make sure that you're not misinterpreting your inner voice for his small, still small voice. If what you're hearing from God is something you want to hear, and you say, yeah, thank you, Lord, that's what I wanted, there's a pretty good chance that's not God speaking. And I don't know if anybody else struggles with it, but I have times when I have to ask, is that you, God, or is that me? There have been times when there was no question. It was so far outside of my perception of what I would expect God to say that it blew me out of the water. Those are the ones I know are God. Because, well, they could also, I guess, be the enemy, but I don't think I do enough to get his attention. Since he is finite, God is infinite. I did figure out one time that and this was a few years back, so the number's even shorter today since the population's exploding. But if we evenly share the devil's time and we live a standard, I think I used 70-year lifespan, we're going to have 3 seconds of the devil's attention in our lifetime. Now, I'm guessing that folks like Billy Graham and even Pastor David and Pastor Nick are going to get more time than I am because I'm less than a threat. But the enemy is finite. And yeah, there are other demons. But we have God to fight that battle for us. So we don't need to be sitting on the edge of our seat saying, oh no, the Lord's after me. That's usually you're after yourself. And that's what I want you to understand about God's voice. You'll either A, know it is him, and you'll hear something totally impossible, and that's an affirmation that it's him. But, and this was pretty much an impossible situation for Paul. But did he panic and say, oh God, that's impossible? He assumed it was done, and it was. And as I hope I pointed out, I mean, this, we read through the story and we don't really look at, we see God moving, but we zip on through and say, you know, Paul helped by telling, and yeah, he did the one thing that he could do, which was get the report on upstairs. But that in itself required God's intervention. And God made sure that what he said was the truth of the situation, not the outcome of what was probable or what looked like a propositional truth. Those 3 questions you can look at and call life lessons if you want. I didn't for no real reason other than the fact that they're not necessarily applicable to all, and I hope that life lessons are, but they are on your sheet and it's something to prayerfully consider. Now, one other salient point in this passage, and this runs throughout almost all of the New Testament, but look at the position of the Romans. Romans in general and centurions in particular are almost always represented at worst as neutral tools God is using, but quite often they are exemplary righteous men. I had this once in a teaching a while back, and I'm sort of making up the figures because I don't remember exactly, but there's 7 or 8 or 9 named encounters with centurions, and almost all of them, the centurion is a righteous man doing the right thing. Now, what hit me today about that, and anybody that hasn't questioned the authority and the reliability of Scripture is going to vote for anybody that tells you what you want to hear, because you need to test even that. Now, I believe it. We believe it here as a church. But my telling you to believe it and you doing it based on me telling you to do it is not the way to get there. Look at Scripture. The New Testament was written, well, I almost said almost entirely, but as far as we know, entirely by Jews and by one Gentile slave. And these are not people that are going to be predisposed to love the Romans, who were conquerors and subjugators of their people and their land. Almost universally, Israelites hated the Romans. I'm sure there were exceptions, and there were plenty of collaborators, but that doesn't mean they had a love for the Romans. That means they had a love for themselves and wanted to get by as best they could. Now, think about this, and this was my point. Do you not suppose that if humans were the authors of the Bible instead of God, that they might have painted the Romans in a somewhat less complimentary fashion? I know I would have. If I were writing a history of the South, I won't go there. But I would at least try to be balanced. But this is almost universally pro-Roman. And the only time you really see the Romans being put in a very dark light is when they are crucifying Jesus. But even there, you have the centurion that said he was a witness that surely this is a man of God. And you have soldiers doing their jobs. And we need to remember that Jesus could have gotten off that cross any time. So even the worst of the soldiers that enjoyed torturing him and putting him to death were doing God's will and his bidding. Okay, and there's no extra charge for that extra salient point there, but that did just hit me while I was doing this. I said, well, you know, this shows me the Bible is true. And even when you're not looking, you're going to see that when God wants to put it on your heart. But if you look, you'll find all kinds of examples that say, well, you know, if I was writing this, I don't know that I would have shared that. And that's because no man wrote the Bible. They were inspired by God to put in there what God wanted there. I like teaching for at least one selfish reason, and it is a truism about teaching. And I expect to see at least one head nod here, but probably several. In trying to teach others, we invariably learn new things ourselves. So when you get an opportunity to teach, do. Even if it's one-on-one, that is a teaching situation. But make sure you're studying and preparing. And we are told to be prepared at all times to give evidence of why we have faith. And that's something to study. So you are prepared for that. And just, well, yeah, because I know it's true because I was told, you know, isn't a very good argument. But if you can come up with, this is why I believe, and if we're saying, you better believe or you're going to hell, I don't know anybody that likes a finger wagged at them, because we're all human, and that's something to resist. But I can tell you that I'm stealing this, and you've probably heard it before, that I'm a poor beggar, and this is where I found bread, and you can too. If we are doing it in humility and saying that, you know, I know what love is because I've been shown love. I don't know anybody that doesn't want to be loved, however tough a demeanor they may be putting on. All right. Let's see. We're going to conclude with an advertisement and prayer. Some of you may have noticed I didn't finish the rest of the scripture. Well, you were invited, and whether you want to hear it or not, you're invited to come Saturday morning, because it just so happens I get to do that again, and I realized I'd be running another 20 or 30 minutes if I'd kept going with the rest of it. So come on Saturday morning, join us for men's fellowship, enjoy breakfast. I think it's changed, but I don't really know what it is, but we'll be fed. Work day. Okay. And don't let the work scare you like it does me. But in any case, I encourage you to come. And as Paul Harvey used to say, for the rest of the story, and if you don't know who Paul Harvey is, well, there are some advantages to being old. And you can probably find him on the internet, which couldn't have happened in my day. So praise God. Let's pray, and then we'll... Yeah.
One thing I missed, you said there is a test that you can do to tell whether you're actually hearing from God or you think you're hearing
from God. Did I actually say that? I may have. I want you to test whether it is or not. But the one that has never failed me is if I think that I can accomplish what God just told me to do, it hasn't been God in my experience. And look through the Bible. How many of the men that heard from God, and there are plenty of examples. First of all, how many heard from him all the time? There are a few that walk closer than others. I would say Moses daily. Some of the prophets probably daily because they needed it. But we hear from God when he has something for us to do, and it's something that we can't imagine how we can accomplish it. That would be my test. And that one hasn't failed me. The adventure I'm not going to tell you about, but I was referring to earlier, is being told to pick up and leave and go to Alaska. And we did, and saw miracle after miracle after miracle until we got there and tried to do what we thought God wanted us to do. And then there was silence until we turned back to him and said, well, everything we were going to do has failed. What do you want us to do? And then right back in. So, again, if you belong to God, you'll know his voice. And not for me, not every time. And sometimes it is Jim's voice trying to sound like God. But that will also get you to a point of being in trouble. But God's always there for you. You say, oh, sorry, God, I thought that was you, but I've screwed up. I got one of those stories too. I'll give you that one. It's a short one. When I was in divinity school, I was working and going to school full time. Not easy to do, especially if you're like me, and I was raised Presbyterian, so I didn't have that much Bible background. So I was playing catch up in a Baptist seminary, because all these people have grown up with it for the most part. But I ran into, I had a friend, brilliant guy, makes money without thinking about it, brought to me this, I'm going to do this, and we can make 10 to 20% a month on our money. So what does Jim do? He borrows $50,000 on credit cards and says, okay, my school's taken care of. I can quit my job. It worked for 2 months and then lost it all. He panicked, which is so out of character with him, that almost had to be God, and did something that he probably shouldn't have. And I won't say it all, but out of $50,000, I recovered 8 or 9. So I was in bad debt for quite a while after that. So, and I thought that was God. And honestly, I have one pastor friend from a ways back, but he told me, God wants me to leave my wife so I can be happy. You test it against the Bible when you hear from God, and that's going to reveal it pretty often. That's a better test than the other one. But if it's not against biblical principles and what God has said in the past, because God's not going to contradict himself. And that was the case for the money. You know, and there's probably 30 or 40 Proverbs that covers not doing what I did. But it is a matter of walking with him. And don't panic if you aren't sure whether it's God's voice or not. And don't panic when you ask God for an answer to a serious problem or a serious choice and you don't hear from him. Because, I mean, if the answer is no, he's going to give that to you because he loves you. If the answer is yes, he's going to give that to you because he loves you. But if you don't hear from him about something that's really you're struggling with, the answer is usually is, I'm going to walk with you whichever way you choose to go. Because he does not want, if he had wanted us to be autonomous, I can't say the word, autonomous, puppets, yay, that's the word. If he wanted us to be puppets, he would have created us that way. But he gave us free will so we can choose to love him or reject him. Because without that choice, the love doesn't mean anything. So, and I think I actually said it last week, but the part about Martin Luther saying, sin boldly, and it usually gets dropped there, but remember the rest of it. It's because you have a God that is going to, and I'm paraphrasing, it's because you have a God that loves you and is going to cover your sins if you are pursuing him. We're still going to make mistakes. But you don't panic about them. You expect God to do the best he can in every choice you make, bad or good. And he will, because he's a loving father. So if you make the worst choice in the world and then put that in his hands, he'll make something good come of it. Even if it means you're going to prison for 10 years, you'll grow through that process. There's laughter. Nobody wants to go to prison for 10 years. And I don't think Paul went to prison for 10 years, but he sure went to prison a lot. And God used it every time, often for the good of the prisoners and guards. So whatever your situation, and that takes us back to the first life lesson. Stop it. I guess I could have turned you off. But whatever your situation, God is greater than the situation. And the truth is in him, not in what you think is going to happen because of the odds being against you or for you. In my case, the odds were for me in the gambling. And that is probably the biggest life lesson that isn't part of this, but we need to trust God in all things. Our attempts at glory in him and our shame where we've made mistakes and done the wrong thing at the wrong time and hurt people. But we can trust God with making the best of both of those situations. I use it a lot and I'll use it now. We want to be in a place and we want to expect God to do all things for our good and for his glory. Any other questions? Then we'll pray. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we break the law. And the law is there primarily to show us first, not how to hurt ourselves and hurt others, and second, and most important, that we are sinners in need of a Savior. And you are a great Savior. And your ability to forgive, correct, and make holy is far greater than the worst sins we can commit. And Lord, in loving you, we need to look at and we want to not sin. And you said multiple times that if you love me, keep my commandments. And then we turn around and we can't. But if our heart is trying to please you in all that we do, you're going to bless that. And you're going to draw us closer to yourself. And it may be terribly painful for a time. But Lord, let us live in the reality, the truth of knowing that you as Father, you as Jesus, our brother, and you as Holy Spirit are there to perfect us and to bring us into your glory as brothers of Christ, clothed in his perfection. And that's the eternal truth. And all the temporal things that plague us daily are, as I loved it when I first heard it and still do, you know, our entire time here, once we're with you in eternity, will be like a single bad night in a cheap motel. And we look forward to being home with you, but in doing it and getting there victorious and following you as much as we are able through our life here. And Lord, we don't like it here, but we do recognize this is the place where we do get to make choices that are to love or to hate, to give or to take, and to see what our character is so that we can then recognize how wonderful it is to be in your presence and not worry about our bad choices ever again. Lord, we thank you, we love you, we pray in your holy name, amen.